welcome to UDC Forum. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber, Director of the Division of Humanities at the University of the District of Columbia Community College, and your host. This program is the second of a three-part series in which my guests and I explore two significant constitutional amendments that have helped to shape the America we live in today, the 15th and 19th Amendments. The 15th Amendment, granting African American men the right to vote, was formally adopted into the U.S. Constitution on March 30, 1870. Passed by Congress the year before, the amendment reads, "The rights of citizens of the United States to vote shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or by any state on account of race, color, or previous condition of servitude." Despite the amendment, by the late 1870s, various discriminatory practices were used to prevent African Americans from exercising their right to vote, especially in southern states. After decades of discrimination, the Voting Rights Act of 1965 aimed to overcome legal barriers at the state and local levels that denied African Americans the right to vote under the 15th Amendment. The 19th Amendment, passed by Congress on June 4, 1919, and ratified on August 18, 1920, guarantees all American women the right to vote. The amendment reads, "The rights of citizens of the United States to vote shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or by any state on account of sex. Congress shall have power to enforce this article by appropriate legislation." Achieving this milestone required a lengthy and difficult struggle. Victory took decades of agitation and protest. Beginning in the mid-19th century, several generations of women suffrage supporters lectured, wrote, marched, lobbied, and practiced civil disobedience to achieve what many Americans considered a radical change to the American Constitution. Voting rights in America, from the 15th Amendment to the 19th Amendment and beyond, is the topic of this UDC Forum three-part series. Joining me to discuss the women's suffrage movement, which led to the adoption of the 19th Amendment and the legal significance of both the 15th and 19th constitutional amendments, are Elizabeth Meyer, a museum professional who specializes in creating both hands-on and minds-on learning experiences for children, adults, and families. In her current role as a director of program for the National Women's History Museum in Alexandria, Virginia, and its online resource at www.nwhm.org, Elizabeth creates historical content and programs that bring women's history into popular culture. Wade Henderson is the president and CEO of the Leadership Conference on Civil and Human Rights and the Leadership Conference Education Fund. The Leadership Conference is the nation's premier civil and human rights coalition, charged by its diverse membership of more than 200 national organizations to promote and protect the civil and human rights of all persons in the United States. Through advocacy and outreach to targeted constituencies, the Leadership Conference works toward the goal of a more open and just society. The Education Fund builds public will for civil and human rights through campaigns that empower and mobilize civil and human rights advocates around the country to push for progressive change. Mr. Henderson is also the Joseph L. Ryle, Jr. Professor of Public Interest Law at the David A. Clark School of Law, University of the District of Columbia. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Both of you have such impressive resumes. This is such an important topic, mm-hmm. and so I'm glad that we have your expertise mm-hmm. here.
Yeah.
Wade, if I may call you Wade.
Please, please, Sid.
There
Dr.
is
Jowers.
Such a tension in the air.
Yeah.
Now, the political climate, a lot of it fostering on the ambition of some states
yeah.
to pass legislation, making it more difficult for members to vote, and that membership or that population is usually of color and poor. So we see, are we regressing?
Boy, what a great question. Well, first of all, I'm delighted to be here, Dr. Jowers-Barber. May I call you Sandy?
Yes, please.
I appreciate that. And Ms. Maurer, may I call you Elizabeth?
Yes.
Thank you so much, guys. First of all, I'm delighted that you are bringing this topic of an analysis of the 15th Amendment and the 19th Amendment of the Constitution to your viewers. The issue of racial equality in American life, in which we are still a work in progress as a country, applies as well to the rights of women. We are still a work in progress. And interestingly, the struggle for equality, both on the basis of race and gender, gender equality, springs from the same wellspring of inequality built into the American Constitution when it was first ratified in 1787. African Americans were legally held in bondage under the Constitution, which proclaimed the rights of man and the equality of all, and women were denied the right to vote, were denied property rights, were essentially in bondage to their husbands and often to their family. And it was that same wellspring of inequality that kept both groups out of the Constitution and the meaning of citizenship and personhood. And there was one state, New Jersey, that actually provided for women under their own state constitution and subsequently stripped them of the right to vote, I think in 1807. So, I mean, there's a long history of denial of both. Your question about a comparison with today and the struggles to bring equality to African Americans in this country is especially, I think, prescient and appropriate. You know, the 15th Amendment to the Constitution was one of three amendments that were adopted in the immediate aftermath of the Civil War to end slavery as we knew it, which was, of course, the 13th Amendment to the Constitution, to provide citizenship and equality under law, which was the 14th Amendment to the Constitution, and to guarantee the right to vote to, in this instance, African-American men under the 15th Amendment to the Constitution. Women were still barred, interestingly enough, from their the right to vote. And it just shows you how deep gender inequality is in our country, to the extent that race could be acknowledged and overcome, at least for men, as a basis to vote, and yet gender could not for the basis of women. And that is really troubling. Now, as you pointed out, after the passage of the 15th Amendment, for a very brief period, African Americans excelled in politics and in life under the Reconstruction government that the Republican Party at that time had put into place. You know, I think Hiram Rebels was our first elected senator from Mississippi shortly after the adoption of the 15th Amendment in 1870. And we had over 600 elected state officials that came about almost immediately after the passage of that amendment. At one level, it is surprising that a group held in bondage in slavery for so long could suddenly emerge with a class of individuals who understood the importance of American democracy at its core and could take their rightful place as leaders, not just of their own community, but of the nation. And that was a remarkable turn of events. Of course, when Reconstruction ended in 1878, when the Hayes-Tilden Compromise was adopted, and we went through a prolonged period of racial inequality and apartheid under American law, we, of course, were denied the right to vote in a systematic way until 1965, when Congress passed the Voting Rights Act, which was intended to give force and effect to the right of the 15th Amendment guarantee to the right to vote. And that had done very well. But now fast forward, we're about to have the presidential election of 2016. As you know, this election has had a backdrop of tension and inequality, class structure. We are, as a nation, going through a paradigmatic shift in our American politics, and the emergence of Donald Trump as the Republican candidate and Hillary Clinton as the Democratic candidate, two of the most unpopular candidates in the history of our electorate, and yet the choices between the two candidacies could not be more stark. And what we are now seeing is that the right to vote has become central to the question of whether this election will be fair. And so this is the first election in 50 years that has not enjoyed the full protection of the Voting Rights Act. And that's because in 2013, the Supreme Court of the United States stripped the right to vote guaranteed under the Constitution and the Voting Rights Act of 1965 by invalidating a key provision of the Voting Rights Act that allowed the Department of Justice to exercise oversight in state election processes. And when that provision was invalidated, the case was known as Shelby County versus Holder. Shelby County, by the way, is in Alabama, one of the most racially segregated states in the history of our country. And to find that it is now used as the tool to undo the Voting Rights Act is especially ironic. And yet this is the first election without the full protection of the Act. And so that's a huge problem.
Wait, let me just ask you one question before I ask Elizabeth to come in here. When you said strip the right to vote, because many times students will come and say, we can't vote.
Let me be precise, because you're absolutely right, Sandy, and I'm glad you raised it. The right to vote is protected. Everyone has the right to vote. The decision did not strip the right to vote. So let me clarify. What the decision did, that is the Shelby County versus Holder decision, it invalidated a formula under Section 4 of the Voting Rights Act that identified jurisdictions that would be subject to what's called preclearance, which means that the Department of Justice has to review and approve of any changes in your election system between the last election and now. And so the Justice Department had to review that. Now that preclearance helped to guard against shenanigans that might be adopted at the state level that made it harder to vote. So for example, some states had early voting, which would allow you to actually vote days before the election took place. Those dates have been shortened. Some states adopted voter ID requirements that meant that everyone in the state had to have a specific kind of ID in order to vote. So here's the irony. In a place like Texas, if you had a concealed carry permit to carry a handgun and concealed, you could use that to identify yourself for purposes of voting. But if you had a student ID issued from a state university system, that wasn't sufficient to qualify you to vote. So the voter ID issues were extremely problematic. And those restrictions have had a profound impact on the fairness of the upcoming election. In North Carolina, we just recently had a federal court of appeals, the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals, one of the most powerful courts in the country, say that North Carolina's voter ID system was in fact created specifically out of racial animus and hostility directed toward the African American community most specifically. It's the first time that we've seen a federal court issue that kind of indictment for a voting system created with the specific intent of disenfranchising African American voters, and it's a huge problem. So you're absolutely right to make that clarification.
So what does that say in terms of the 15th Amendment, the significance of it, and where we are now? Is it, and we have individuals say, I'm not going to vote because my vote doesn't count, or they're taking away the vote. We're having these conversations come up again. What are we saying to those voters who are sitting out because they think that they're being eliminated?
No, I understand. And I'm glad, again, Sandy, that you raised the issue. You know, in our country, voting is the language of democracy. You know, if you don't vote, you don't count. And the truth is, by not voting, you are in fact casting a vote in favor of your opposition. When you don't vote, it's not as if your vote doesn't happen in the ether. What you have done is you have given your opposition a leg up because you chose not to cast a ballot. Now, many people who are frustrated by the quality of life they have, they blame both Democrats and Republicans, sometimes equally, for the problems they experience. They fail to make distinctions in party platforms. They fail to make distinctions between the kinds of political activity that one party or the other may use to create a particular outcome of denying certain job benefits or assistance to education, or call it what you will. But people who say that their vote doesn't matter, in fact, are naive. And I don't think they fully appreciate how our system operates. So let me be clear. Everyone has an obligation to vote, not just as a commitment to citizenship in our country, but in their own self-interest. when you choose not to vote, you are waiving your self-interest in the outcome of a key election, which has a direct impact on the quality of life you experience. And you are giving to people who don't share your interests and values the power to shape your life. Now, is that really a smart decision? I think not.
We're going to take a pause right here. You're watching UDC Forum from the University of the District of Columbia. We'll return after these messages.
We're building an advanced public system of higher learning that serves the community of the District of Columbia. We selected all of those words very carefully because they all have important meanings. Because none of it really works unless you have a public higher education system that can connect it all together. Well, one of the best kept secrets about the University of the District of Columbia is that we have many quality programs. Our workforce development unit is of a high quality and puts people in jobs each and every day. Our land grant unit, which is serving constituents all over the district, we're the only urban land grant institution in the country. I think that we have all the pieces that we can put together in a way that will allow us to take best practices, best tools, and really wipe the slate clean and redesign ourselves as an advanced public system of higher learning that can serve the district in a way that allows us to be a model of higher education in a city that wants to be a model city for the rest of the country.
Don't tell me I can't sit where I want.
Don't tell me I can't be an inventor.
Don't tell me I can't be a soldier.
Don't tell me I can't be a movie star. I am Anna Mae Wong.
I am Rosa Parks. I refuse to give up my bus seat to a white person.
I am Tabitha Babbitt. I invented the circular saw.
Don't tell me I can't fly.
Don't tell me I can't be an explorer.
I am Sacagawea.
Don't tell me I can't be a scientist. I'm Gertie Teresa Corey. I won a Nobel Prize in Physiology.
I am Deborah Sampson.
Don't tell me I can't open my own business. I'm Estee Lauder. I started a global empire that now has $7 billion in annual sales.
I disguise myself as a man to fight in the Revolutionary War.
Don't tell me I can't be a spy.
Don't tell me I can't be a journalist.
I am Mary Elizabeth Bowser.
I'm Amelia Earhart.
I starred in over 40 films from the silent era to the talkies.
I am Hovita Idar. I was an editor, a publisher, and I even founded my own newspaper.
During the Civil War, I was a maid for the Confederate president. He thought I was illiterate, but I actually had a photographic memory.
I was shot twice in my first battle and removed the bullets myself.
These are just some of the women who have changed history. Don't let them be forgotten.
Become a member and support the National Women's History Museum.
Follow us on Twitter and Facebook.
Welcome back to UDC Forum. My guests are Elizabeth Maurer, Director of Program for the National Women's History Museum in Alexandria, Virginia, and Wade Henderson, President and CEO of the Leadership Conference on Civil and Human Rights and the Leadership Conference Education Fund. And he is also the Joseph L. Rao Jr. Professor of Public Interest Law at the David A. Clark School of Law, University of the District of Columbia. We are discussing the topic of voting rights in America, from the 15th Amendment to the 19th Amendment and beyond. Elizabeth, you're going to the 19th Amendment.
Okay.
Wade made a statement that this election has two of the most unpopular candidates, and one of them is a woman. How mm-hmm. significant is that almost 90 years after the passing of the 19th Amendment?
90 years after the passage of the 19th Amendment, but actually more than 100 years after the very first woman ran for president, which was in the 1870s, and then the first serious candidate for president in the 1880s. Right? And I was listening really intently to what you said, Wade, and I thought you made a really good point about the importance of voting today and why this is an issue mm-hmm. that should be taken very personally by not just us, but like everyone. And it made me think about how the issue of voting even became, in many ways, the linchpin around notions of equality, right, in this country. So when you go back to the founding of the country and you think about the promise of the Constitution, right? It's this document that says we are creating this equal society, the most free society in the world at that time, the most equal society in the world at that time, and holding out this democratic promise that that the people, as we went into the new republic, really embraced. Now, the divide between sort of the promise of the Constitution and people's actual everyday lives was pretty significant. And the United States has been really working ever since then to the present and into the future to overcome these divides, these mm-hmm. issues. So we're this work in progress, moving towards greater equality, right, that we were not enjoying. So what happens, I think, around the 19th Amendment is that voting becomes this kind of symbol of equality, if you will. So in the early 19th century, there are lots of different groups who are activistly working towards improving our country and the lives of the people who live in it. So you have the abolitionist movement that's identified slavery as a significant problem that's leading to inequality and is not fulfilling the promise of the Constitution. There's a peace movement that is happening at the same time, how war is destructive to our society. There are movements around temperance. So alcohol has been identified as a significant problem, you know. And then they just keep going on. And the people who are working in these movements to improve the country oftentimes find that their barrier to success has to do with their lack of access to voting, right? Because you can gather thousands of names on a petition saying that women should have property rights, right? Because women didn't have, married mm-hmm. women couldn't own property. And if you can't own property, you can't have a business. And if you can't have a business, you can't support yourself. Or a married woman couldn't go to court. She couldn't be the guardian of her own children, right? So these are issues that are keeping women, and these issues are replicated across other groups mm-hmm. as well. It's keeping women from equality. And you can submit a petition to a local legislator with thousands of names on it, and they're going to go down the list, aren't they, and identify which of these people do I have to listen to. And the people they have to listen to are the ones who have the power to vote them in or out of office. So these leaders like Lucretia Mott or Elizabeth Cady Stanton or Susan B. Anthony, they keep coming back to the same solution to the problem of getting their voices heard, which is they have to be able to vote, because it's only through voting that you truly have the power to affect change. And I believe that you see generations of people following them who continue to come to the same conclusion, right? Which is how we came to the Voting Rights Act, which is how we came to this other legislation. It's like you have to be able to vote to affect change.
One of the things that Frederick Douglass felt, of course, was it was mandatory and necessary mm-hmm. that people be able to vote, and especially men. At that time, women were not on the horizon. It was not going to happen. But we also see the seeds of tension sowed here around this language of voting and this ability to vote, which identifies you as a citizen, as someone who is on the list and has to be listened to. So we see there's the tension here between, is it going to be these newly freed men who showed how capable they were? Mm-hmm. And sometimes people think because people were enslaved, they were stupid, they were ignorant. How did these men, how were they? They were brilliant people all along. And people were able to ascend and show that they were worthy. So now you've got a group of women, white women who were privileged. Mm-hmm. You know, it took some wherewithal to travel around and do all this. You had to have some wherewithal. So they are looking at these men who are, at one point, were enslaved and uneducated and all of that. They get the right to vote, and they are still struggling with this.
Right.
And so this wasn't well received.
Well, it goes actually back to the 14th Amendment. Mm-hmm. Right. So you have the three amendments that come right at the end of the Civil War. So, like you said, the 13th Amendment abolishes slavery as an institution within the United States, and it declares that the people who had been enslaved can now no longer be enslaved. Mm-hmm. So first you have to end slavery. The 14th Amendment is really the linchpin behind that break between really the white elite women suffragists who were leading the movement because they had the education, they had the money, they had the ability to do that, and then the African American community, right, of newly freed people. So the 14th Amendment was meant to establish citizenship as a right of all people who are born in the U.S. or its territories, which is incredibly important, right? Because there had been a movement to say that if these folks weren't citizens before, they can't be citizens mm-hmm. now, and you can see the cascade of problems that's going mm-hmm. to arise from that. It also established that all of these new citizens are also whole people. So it's solving the three-fifths problem that had come about in case law before that. Mm-hmm. And representation. But the crux of the problem was in introducing the word male suffrage into the 14th Amendment. It's the first time that gender had ever been a consideration in the Constitution. And by introducing male suffrage into the 14th Amendment, it undercut a key argument that the suffragists had had up until that time, which was that the Constitution did not explicitly say that women could not vote, and that they had had the right all along to vote, and it was simply custom and local implementation and creation of voting laws, which are still local, that was keeping women from voting. So when they were talking about male enfranchisement, Elizabeth Cady Stanton says, once you get the word male in, it's gonna take 100 years to get it out. Well, it didn't take 100, but it took 50, right? So she wasn't wrong about that, yeah. Right? And having been in this movement, really, which was a women's rights movement, mm-hmm. more per se than a voting rights movement mm-hmm. to that time, that was the key focus was, once we introduce gender, then it becomes a gendered issue. Now, what she's not looking at is the political expediency of getting the 14th Amendment passed. Because what she and Susan B. Anthony wanted was to package women and men, and African American men. And ironically, you never think of African American women in all of this, mm-hmm. right? Even though they should be, mm-hmm. they're kind of in both, but they're not in both. But mm-hmm. So they wanted it to be packaged together, and political expediency said, we can't package this together. Mm-hmm. We can't have the women come in with the men because it'll never pass. And this is the moment to get this passed. And as you see, I think fairly quickly afterwards, when the states start erecting barriers to African American male enfranchisement, they were correct about that. Mm-hmm. Right? And so the 15th Amendment becomes necessary to establish it. But the break that occurred, because Elizabeth Cady Stanton is saying, well, if we can't have both, then we should have neither. So the break in the suffrage movement is between this faction that mm-hmm. says we need to have women now or first, right? And used some very racist language and mm-hmm. thought process behind that. And then the more moderate faction, which was Lucy Stone and Henry Blackwell, saying we need to do it sequentially. We'll get this in, and then we'll loop back around and we'll work for the women, mm-hmm. which is in some ways what happened. But then it was a significant period of time.
Mm-hmm. We also see in that narrative where African American women, as you said, who were thinking of them, but there were African American women very active in the movement, mm-hmm. especially in the North, where you had women who were free, mm-hmm. Who had fathers. I'm thinking of mm-hmm. Mary Church Terrell, mm-hmm.
yes.
Frances Hawkins. I mean, there were women who were able to do the things that white women were doing, and we mm-hmm. see when we see the women's club movement coming about, we see that as well. Even though the pushback against the elitist mm-hmm. and bourgeoisie was that we are doing things for the race. Yes, we are well-to-do and we're privileged, but we're doing things for the race. And, mm-hmm. and part of that sort of discourse was White women who are privileged are doing it because they want the right to vote. Mm-hmm. Men already have the right to vote, so they're not trying to bring the men into it. Where black women were initially, even though there were some who I'm sure wanted the right to vote mm-hmm. as much as men, understood the longer picture and the political expediency for them of doing it sequentially. Let's get African-American men the right to vote. We're going to mm-hmm. take a pause right here. You're watching UDC Forum from the University of the District of Columbia. We'll return after these messages.
Don't tell me I can't say what I want.
Don't tell me I can't be a soldier.
Don't tell me I can't be an inventor.
Don't tell me I can't be a movie star.
I am Rosa Parks.
I am Anna May Wong.
I refuse to give up my bus seat to a white person.
I disguise myself as a man to fight in the Revolutionary War.
Don't tell me I can't fly.
I am Amelia Earhart.
I was shot twice in my first battle and removed the bullets myself.
Don't let them be forgotten.
Support National Women's History Museum.
I have the best job of anyone I know. I am surrounded by intensely committed, hard-charging lawyers for social change, lawyers who care about social justice, staff who are here at the law school because of our mission. Our law school has a completely different, pervasive educational methodology. We learn by doing. So instead of taking a course where you read books and articles about juveniles enmeshed in the criminal justice system, at the David A. Clark School of Law, you represent children charged with crimes or children who are in the abuse and neglect system or children with special education needs in court or in administrative hearings. You actually, as a student with close faculty supervision, change their lives. And that's how you learn.
Welcome back to UDC Forum. My guests are Elizabeth Maurer, Director of Program for the National Women's History Museum in Alexandria, Virginia, and Wade Henderson, President and CEO of the Leadership Conference on Civil and Human Rights and the Leadership Conference Education Fund. He is also the Joseph L. Rao Jr. Professor of Public Interest Law at the David A. Clark School of Law, University of the District of Columbia. We're discussing the topic of voting rights in America, from the 15th Amendment to the 19th Amendment and beyond. Elizabeth, let's talk a little bit more about these women. Who had to be extraordinary because, as the what does the bumper sticker say, quiet women seldom make history.
Yes.
So these women had to be very vocal, and we know about the marches and being arrested at the White House and force-fed. Talk a little bit about the stamina and the strategy it took to finally get to the
19th. Get there. I think it was such an incredibly long, really public education process. So we think about the women's rights movement and the voting rights movement for women really starting in 1848 mm-hmm. at the Seneca Falls Convention in New York. And Elizabeth Cady Stanton writes the Declaration of Sentiments, which says these are all of the different kinds of rights that women should have. And really most of them are around legal rights and property rights. And it's voting, which is just kind of tagged on at the end and becomes the most contentious piece of it. Because what they're really challenging was sort of this role of women having a public voice in society, which was not at all how women were supposed to be seen. And then it becomes very interesting is that women become very public in advocating for these rights. So at the very beginning, you have Susan B. Anthony, who's using the technology of the time and getting on a train and traveling across the country and talking to thousands of people. I think an incredibly significant person at that beginning of the movement was Sojourner Truth, mm-hmm. who also used technology, got on a train, traveled across the country, and talked to people. And she was also so smart in that she self-published books and pamphlets that she sold to support her efforts, and also owned the copyright to all of her own images of herself, and sold those to support the effort. And she was key because she was this very early person making the case that she was an African American and she was a woman. And that she really embodies really this promise of equality, and people responded to that. And these women then are at the forefront, and then they're followed by subsequent generations, like Lucy Stone, who's one of my daughter's favorite figures in women's history, right?
I like Lucy Stone.
Who uses the press. They start a newspaper to reach out to people. Or Ida B. Wells Barnett, who was probably one of the most courageous people ever to live. Who had to flee Memphis, Tennessee because she was writing about the scourge of lynching, and they literally burned down her press, right? And wound up in Chicago, where she founds the first black women's suffrage club, the Alpha Club, and is very vocal. So again, technology is key to getting these messages out. Being in front of people and putting out all of this kind of information through the press.
They also traveled. I mean, I'm looking at Ida B. Wells going to England, going to Europe, taking that case on an international scene, and understanding the importance of spreading that outside of the United States, getting that spotlight on the United States. You're a new country. This is the promise. And look at what's going on, even as you're now venturing into an international stage yourself. Look at what's going on. And here's a black woman who is taking this case out.
And can I just, and inspiring people to use the press as this method for getting this information out. So when Alice Paul comes back from England after, in the 20th century, and starts staging protests in front of the White House, where they made these banners, you know, on a light background with letters cut out and stitched in dark print so that they photographed beautifully for the newspaper, right? You can see them wonderfully.
Yes.
This suffrage parade in 1913 that attracted 5,000 marchers, including Ida B. Wells Barnett, who refused to march at the back. Good for her. And then when they get arrested for trespassing, they use those pictures of women in their prison uniforms to get out the message. And they were really the first people to protest in front of the White House and use the press in a way that gets out the message.
And even as they're doing this marching, we see Ida B. Wells sort of bogarting, and that's a dated term, some of what her way in, because there again, there was this tension between women of color and white women trying to vote. And she just sort of, okay, that's not going to be the case. We also see a new sorority, Delta Sigma Theta, being formed, and that's their first political act. It's marching in that parade. So you see women across the spectrum, you know, making sure that their voices are heard as they get involved in pushing this forward.
See, there there are some interesting parallels, and I think Elizabeth highlighted several of them with respect to the activism of the women's movement beginning in 1848 at the same time that the abolitionist movement was building to its crescendo. With the Civil War and the passage of these three amendments, and then fast forward to the use of press and creative communication skills, which were really the Twitter and Facebook of its
time,
day. I mean, of its day. The use of press, self-publishing, getting stuff out, giving speeches, and using, you know, your own pamphlets to help pay for them. All of that was really, in contemporary terms, quite remarkable, and the disruptive use of technology of its day. You also see parallels with the civil and human rights movement of its time. You talked about the trips abroad. This was, of course, done before the United Nations was in place. And these women were using their experiences to, yes, heighten support abroad and to raise money and to support their effort, but also a little bit to embarrass the new American democracy that, you know, was really coming into its own. Now, obviously, we were not the same global power that we were after World War II. But there was still an embarrassment when the United States was the contradictions between what we preached with our documents, like the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution, and what we actually did. Then the other parallel that I thought about, and I think Elizabeth highlighted that as well, was in the decision of some in the suffragette movement to say, look, if we can't include both men and women, mm-hmm. meaning African-American men and white women in the vote, then neither should get it until both can. Mm-hmm. And that was a challenge to the perspective that incrementalism is often needed to advance civil and human rights. And over the next century, you will see examples where a desire for a larger goal had to be sublimated to the advance of more limited goals as a way of moving the process forward. There was such a dispute in the aftermath of the three Civil War amendments that Frederick Douglass mm-hmm. and Elizabeth Cady Stanton and others were at odds with one another over their commitment to the abolitionist movement on the one hand, or to the broader equality movement that included mm-hmm. women on the other. Fast forward then a century later, and you saw in the Obama first election, the 2008 mm-hmm. campaign, tension between Hillary Clinton's campaign at the time and President Obama's campaign, and often you would hear concerns expressed about, you know, the fact that a woman had earned her place on the ticket and Obama was a sort of young upstart who came in and disrupted the progression mm-hmm. of history, and there was deep resentment of that. Fortunately, both President Obama and Secretary Clinton now were able to advance their broader interests and show alignment by coming together in ways that I hope will help advance a broader interest and a broader view of equality down the road. But I think those historic parallels are interesting and worth noting.
And when we look at the generations that came out of the 15th Amendment in terms of the politicians of color, and you mentioned a President Obama, but there is a President Obama.
Yeah.
And we mm-hmm. have, we started, you mentioned mm-hmm. In the 19th century, a woman running, and I'm thinking more specifically of the 20th century of Shirley Chisholm, mm-hmm. A woman of color declaring that she's running. And technology, I remember her buttons, I remember the book mm-hmm. Unbought and Unbossed, I remember some of the speeches that she made. And I also remember the statement when she said the biggest challenge to her was not so much her race, but was her gender.
Oh, absolutely.
And we're talking about the 20th century
absolutely.
Here. Even as we're looking at struggles in the South, the voting, and just coming out of that. So the gender and the race and voting have always been
interwoven.
Yeah. And yeah. so when you, now we're sitting in an election where we have a woman who has earned the Democratic nomination, mm-hmm. and as you said, one of the most two polarizing figures here. What does that say about the country that we've come to?
You know, it's an interesting question, yeah. Sandy, but let me go back for just a minute. I mean, the passage of the 19th Amendment in 1920 was no small feat. It was a significant accomplishment that was born in the struggles of women since 1848. Mm-hmm. I mean, there was a real struggle to have women's issues and framed in equality terms and put on the national agenda. It wasn't until the aftermath of World War I, where the changed dynamic of Europe and the United States allowed women to make that additional push. And the right to vote was not given. They struggled to get it. They took it. They took the right to vote. I mean, that wasn't something that was given to them because some generous benefactor, their husbands or anyone else, had chosen to do it. Now, you know, 1920 was also a time when racism in our country was really almost at an all-time high. I mean, mm-hmm. obviously, slavery was the significant quintessential demonstration of racism. Mm-hmm. But let me say, in the aftermath of World War I, when African-American soldiers returned from Europe, having mm-hmm. tasted a bit of freedom and refusing to go back into the cultural apartheid of the South, began the migration north, and the struggles on the part of employers and others to prevent that from happening, the heightened use of lynching as a way of chastising blacks, the emergence of the original Birth of a Nation, the film that was used to create a psychological barrier to equality.
We'll talk about that in just a moment. You are watching UDC Forum from the University of the District of Columbia, where we turn after these messages.
The whole point of the University of the District of Columbia is to allow every individual who walks into our doors to achieve his or her highest level of potential.
It's a melting pot. I grew up in a very diverse country amongst different cultural people, and being at UDC felt like being home.
I think that combination of the international students, and then there's a lot of students here that are coming back to school and they're older age. So it's very well-rounded in that way.
So that to be able to combine the quality with the affordability and the diversity makes us something special and unique in higher education. The people that we serve, which are generally DC public school graduates, although we serve students from all over the world and all over the country, part of what has to happen is that they need to see a better place and a better time and a better possibility in their lives, which is why we say that UDC is the place where dreams begin.
Don't tell me I can't say what I want.
Don't tell me I can't be a soldier.
Don't tell me I can't be an inventor.
Don't tell me I can't be a movie star.
I am Rosa Parks.
I am Anna May Wong.
I refuse to give up my bus seat to a white person.
I disguise myself as a man to fight in the Revolutionary War.
Don't tell me I can't fly.
I am Amelia Earhart.
I was shot twice in my first battle and removed the bullets myself.
Don't let them be forgotten.
Support National Women's History Museum.
Welcome back to UDC Forum. My guests are Elizabeth Maurer, Director of Program for the National Women's History Museum in Alexandria, Virginia, and Wade Henderson, President and CEO of the Leadership Conference on Civil and Human Rights and the Leadership Conference Education Fund. He is also the Joseph L. Rao Jr. Professor of Public Interest Law at the David A. Clark School of Law, University of the District of Columbia. We are discussing the topic of voting rights in America, from the 15th Amendment to the 19th Amendment and beyond. Elizabeth, tell us about your organization and how it's promoting not only the history of women's suffrage, but also what's going to happen in the future.
Oh, in the future. So, National Women's History Museum is a nonprofit organization that is dedicated to educating Americans about the essential role of women in American history. And we are also raising public awareness about the need for a National Women's History Museum that you can visit in Washington, D.C. So while we're working towards these goals, we have a number of different programs in place where we're educating about women's history. Mm-hmm. And I was so happy to come here today because one of our current projects is around the idea of American democracy. So our website has more than 25 exhibits about different aspects of women's history. And we've been really working hard over the last year to bring in this thread of democracy and moving towards democracy. So we have an exhibit about all the women who've run for president. We have a wonderful exhibit called Standing Up for Change, which is the history of women in the civil rights movement from Sojourner Truth, almost all the way up to the present. We have a very robust resource center on the history of suffrage that highlights all these different issues and then the different people and documents that moved it forward. So what we're hoping is that as we move towards the 100th anniversary of the ratification of the 19th Amendment in 2020, so just 4 years from now, that we're going to be continuing to bring in these kinds of programs, and you can go on our walking tour on women's suffrage, and in a couple of years we're going to have a civil rights walking tour down at the other end of the mall, so that we're all starting to think about the role of women, but also the role of women in their sort of different identities. Because women are not a unified group.
Yes, and this is so interesting. And you're thinking of a presence on the mall?
Well, that would be lovely. There is a congressional commission that's meeting now that is talking, that's going to return a report to Congress about a National Women's History Museum, and we're looking forward to seeing what the results of that commission are.
Excellent. Wait, tell us about the leadership conference and your
sure.
plans.
Thank you, Sandy. The Leadership Conference on Civil and Human Rights is really the nation's leading civil and human rights coalition. We have over 200 national organizations, as we say, working to build an America as good as its ideals. I'm a lawyer by training. I work as a civil rights lobbyist here in Washington, and I work with Congress, I work with the executive branch, President Obama's team, to try to advance goals on civil and human rights. So right now, education, K through 12, is a primary goal, trying to achieve equity in educational funding, to improve the quality of schools available to our children, because that is the key to making progress on equality. We're working on criminal justice issues. There is a tremendous inequality and inherent injustice in our criminal justice system, where we have, obviously, these police shootings over the past 2 years, beginning with Michael Brown in Ferguson and with all the ones that have happened in between, have really helped shine a light on some of the problems in our criminal justice system, some of the inequality, and the need for reform. I want to give a tip of the hat both to former Attorney General Eric Holder and current Attorney General Loretta Lynch for really shining a light on the need to achieve reform in both areas. Voting rights, which of course is the subject of this conversation, is absolutely key. I mean, we have the first presidential election to take place in 50 years without the immediate protection of the Voting Rights Act, the full protection. We're likely to see voter irregularities of the worst sort, and the Department of Justice is limited in the number of election observers it can deploy, because in fact the Shelby County versus Holder decision that I mentioned a bit ago has undercut the ability of the department, has taken away its statutory authority to send monitors to and observers to particular areas. So we've invited, for example, the Organization of Security and Cooperation in Europe to send 400 observers to this election, because we need to make sure that the right to vote is not impaired through shenanigans and irregular procedures, and we're going to do that. We're working on immigration reform. It's a huge issue. It's an issue that affects the country in total. It's an issue that affects not just Latinos, but African Americans, Asians, and others. And it's one that our country has to take seriously. You know, we look at issues involving indigenous rights. We are looking at what's going on with the Sioux tribe in the Standing Rock Sioux tribe in North Dakota, and the Dakota Alliance Pipeline, which is really the source of struggle, and which Native nations have said, look, the procedures that were used ignored the rights and preferences of indigenous populations, and we need to be heard. And we want to amplify their voices and the voices of the other groups I've mentioned, and I use my skills as a lawyer and advocate here in Washington to make that happen. You know, I also think that what Elizabeth said and the rights of women are central to this. You know, our human rights portfolio at the Leadership Conference includes an effort on our part to have the United States Senate ratify a human rights treaty known as the Convention Against on the the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, known by its acronym CEDAW, C-E-D-A-W. It's a treaty that should be a no-brainer for the U.S., because it essentially proclaims women to be equal beings under American law, and our commitment to strive for equality in pay, in education, in opportunity. The fact that we can't get our Senate to take that treaty seriously is itself a metaphor for how women are treated in American society. The fact that Elizabeth is struggling to get a museum that recognizes the role that women have played in creating the democracy that we celebrate today is, I think, an important recognition. And in the spirit of the African American History Museum, which is just about to open, recognizing the profound impact that that will have on how we as a nation view ourselves, so too as a museum on behalf of women, I think a real tribute to what this country has done and where we are today.
I think it's quite interesting that as we await the mm-hmm. opening of this museum, which will include, mm-hmm. of course, contributions of women, it is telling that we are in such a period as this, where you mentioned bringing in observers from out of the country to mm-hmm, look at mm-hmm. the voting practices of the United States. Mm-hmm. It is just putting us, it appears, for some that we have not advanced as far as we think we have advanced, if some of these practices are still ongoing and the reception is not there, the museum is absolutely wonderful. It took a long period of time to get it.
Absolutely. And
so I'm hoping that it won't take as long for the Women's Museum. But I think what is important is that these organizations that you are involved in, mm-hmm. that you are leading and are the engine driving them, is making the public aware and combating these injustices and making policy that's going to be so crucial. And to have men and women involved in it is going to be just essential for us to go forward. I would like to thank my guest, Elizabeth Maurer, Director of Program for the National Women's History Museum in Alexandria, Virginia, and Wade Henderson, President and CEO of the Leadership Conference on Civil and Human Rights and the Leadership Conference Education Fund. He is also the Joseph L. Raw, Jr., Professor of Public Interest Law at the David A. Clark School of Law, University of the District of Columbia. Founded in 1996, the National Women's History Museum is a nonpartisan 501c3 nonprofit organization dedicated to educating the general public about the diverse historic contributions of women and raising awareness about the critical need for a National Women's History Museum in our nation's capital. If you would like more information, visit the website of the National Women's History Museum at www.nwhm.org. Founded in 1950, the Leadership Conference on Civil and Human Rights is a coalition charged by its diverse membership of more than 200 national organizations to promote and protect the civil and human rights of all persons in the United States. Through advocacy and outreach to targeted constituencies, the Leadership Conference works towards the goal of a more open and just society, an America as good as its ideals. If you would like more information about the Leadership Conference on Civil and Human Rights, visit their website at www.civilrights.org. Finally, if you're interested in learning more about the academic programs and events offered by the University of the District of Columbia, visit the university's website at www.udc.edu. And to learn more about the academic programs and many certificate and training programs offered by the University of the District of Columbia Community College, visit the website at www.cc.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber.